Yes, we certainly are. After Maria, a very warm welcome into your 2023 Greyhound Preview Show of the Duke of Edinburgh Silver Collar and the Waterloo Cup. I'm joined in studio by Mark Rosanowski and Rosso. We say it every year, but we've got a fantastic field, and it's great to see No Keeper back trying to defend his title.
It certainly is. It's not an easy thing to do. Only Ring the Bell has done it so far in terms of being back-to-back in 2017 and 18. We've always got a reference. The great Tivoli Tom, who managed to win two silver collars, albeit a year apart, and unfortunately couldn't take place, take his place in the year in between. But No Keeper is just a champion dog. He's not just the defending champion. $327,000 in stakes. If he wins the collar again, he'll only be about $7,000 underneath Little Mother's all-time stakes record in New Zealand of $377,000. And the amazing thing about it is that he's come out and won a heat, Phillipa, and he's not even the favourite.
Absolutely, he is not. That's because it's a little bit of young and old. We've seen it over the last couple of months with Gold Star Kalito. And as I say, a very good morning to you, Andy McCook. He does look maybe the deserved favourite off the inside rail.
Yeah, he certainly does. Morning, Pip. Morning, Rozzo. Morning, everybody tuning in for the show. Plenty in store for you all. It's a great collar. Be great to see Kevy Boy pick up two in a row. It's no mean feat, and Team Cleve have done a super job to get him back and fighting fit and in a position where he's a chance of winning two. But as you say, favouritism the way of another southerner in Gold Star Carlito, Team Gold Star, and Riley Evans looking to snare their first Group 1. Pretty sure the collar would mean a lot if they could do that for them.
Oh, absolutely, Andy. Well, that is what we're going to be looking forward to. Let's have a look on the show, what's coming up. We will be starting with, of course, it's breaking down the silver collar heats from Sunday. There are some key parts in those runs to have a look at. Our young gun trainer, Riley Evans, joins us live with the favourite Gold Star Kalito as we touch on him. We'll also be going through the field runner by runner as per usual and trying to dive into that form and find a winner for you. Also, we do look forward to the three Waterloo Cup heats out of Addington, Whanganui and Manukau. We'll be catching up with trainer Glenn Hodson as he talks about Golden Logger, who was one of the significant heat winners out of Hattrick Raceway. And we'll be going through the Waterloo Cup field as per usual in depth. So much coming up on the show to enjoy. And before we touch on anything else, we better talk about our 2023 Duke of Edinburgh Silver Collar field.
Runner number one is Gold Star Carlito, the youngster, the new kid on the block. He's looking to give Team Gold Star and Riley Evans their first Group 1 success, trying to hunt down the silver collar.
Number two is Opawa Gina. Jean and Dave Fahey searching for a third Duke of Edinburgh silver collar and a second potentially for Opawa Racing with this girl who's only had five starts in this campaign but has very quickly become a leading fancy.
Another southerner making the trip up is Dog 3, Nighthawk Style for Matt Roberts. She's going around as one of the outsiders of the field. She's won 4 from 75, but she is a greyhound who's been taking on some of our elite stayers basically her entire career.
Dog number 4 will be big time epic, winner of 4 races over the 660 metres at the Manawatu Raceway, her home. The Cole Kennels, they're searching for their first ever Duke of Edinburgh silver collar, and they'll be looking for her to do it from the front after she led up last week in an 1860.
One of the elder statesmen is Raja Bale. He's a tick over 4 years of age, but he is still racing oh so well. He'll venture up as well after a solid third and behind No Keeper for his heat, and he's looking to grab the collar for Craig Roberts.
And here he is in box number 6. It is No Keeper, the winner in an epic battle last week for Gary Cleave and Galen Turmold, and he looks to go back-to-back off the back of a heat win where he did overcome adversity like he did last year to win the final.
The youngster of the field is Dog 7's Sweet Buddy. We've already seen him run and win over the 779-metre journey, so we know he's got the stamina to be competitive. And young trainer Sam Lazell, we know what the collar would mean to him.
And dog number 8 is No Valor, a second runner for Gary and Galeen, a young greyhound on the rise, winner of 2 races over the 645 metres, but he's always looked like a bit further is better.
Absolutely. Well, that is your full field for Sunday's final. Let's have a look at the market. We've already touched on Gold Star Kalito being favourite at 220, the defending champ, No Keeper, second favourite, 240. And Rosso, that was probably apt when we saw the draws come out. Kalito getting the coveted red rug and the fastest heat winner.
Yeah, certainly, and drawn underneath some pace and Opawa Gina. It'd be nice to trail up there. And obviously, big time epic with an outstanding opening sectional last week as well, or the split sectionals for both were obviously very good, but epic overall, an 1860 to a Apawa Junior's 1875. So it looks like, Andy, that Gold Star Carlito can set up in behind, and we know no keeper's champion qualities, and so it's hard to say that the collar is a two-dog race, because it's not, and they've all earned their place there. And I actually think there's a bit of depth in the mid-market here, but Carlito and keeper clearly head and shoulders above the rest in the market.
Yeah, they certainly look it for me as well. I thought Carlito a clear on top selection once the draws have come out. Just maps to get a beautiful run into turn number one. And with that strength he's been showing lately over the 700 metres, and we've seen it in the heat, pulling the best part of four or five lengths off Big Time Epic in the run to the judge. The final straight was super. So things look good for him to track through, get a beautiful run in behind the pace, and from there he looks pretty tough to roll. So $2.20, I think it looks all right around him.
You might want to take that price. Well, it was a little bit cold on Sunday when the heats were run. I can tell you that, a little bit chilly, overcast. What can we expect this Sunday? Well, so far the weather forecast is looking fine. A little bit of the southerlies around, a high of 16 and a low of 10. So, Roz, if we can get that type of weather condition, I think we'll be very happy on Sunday. That's the weather and track conditions. Now let's have a look at the heats. We'll start with No Keeper taking out his heat here in the black and white stripes. He's the dog you want to have a look at, Rozzo. Finds so much trouble in Apawa Junior, who leads up here.
Yeah, it was a bit niggly early, wasn't it? And Apawa Junior getting out to the front here. Look for No Keeper there, but he just wants to muscle out a wee bit into a bit of clear air into that first bend. Also worth a look, obviously, is Raja Bale. Thought his effort, Andy, was very, very good in the blue rug, because he got parked outside Willeen Bale, and we know that that's not a good place to be.
There was certainly no love lost between the kennel mates around this turn here, with Willeen just boring out on Raja. Gee, once he got in front of her, he really started to put the afterburners on. It's been a solid run. A greyhound who's just over 4 years of age now, so him and No Keeper certainly the two oldest in the race, and both showing that they have the fortitude, obviously, over the 779 metres to be competitive. Keeper had to be good here, guys. Had to be very, very good. We know he's a champion, and we know he calls on all those qualities when things aren't going his way. Draw makes it niggly for him, but he's obviously a chance of going back to back.
Absolutely. I mean, that was a very nice heat performance, and we'll take a look at the times and the sectionals. He was very good in his run home, Rosso, as we'd expect here. You can see that with the times. 47.09 overall. Gina sets up the pace with an 18.75, a 30.70 for her second sectional, but the run home was keeper, 16.39, which was very good.
Yeah, well, he's come from a good margin off the 16.39 as well, which has been an outstanding performance. And we saw in that head on, he did take a significant push there, but we saw from last year when he won the final, when, you know, he was in all sorts of bother, to be frank, that he can take that and he can do it, and that's what he has done. He's done it before.
Very tenacious, isn't he? Well, we speak about last year's collar. Let's have a look at the difference. 46.14 was the overall winning time. 18.38 set up by Rogue. Again, it wasn't him up on the speed. And then Rogue with the 30.10 second sectional. But look at his run home, 16.04. And he was good around four or five lengths off these two pacemakers down the back straight, Rosso, but he really brought it home.
He did, and Andy, I guess that's the thing with No Keeper, that if you are backing him, you're probably not going to count yourself out. Depends, obviously, where he is in relation to Carlito, but the great thing about champions is they find a way to win. He did that in the heat, he did it in the final last year.
And we've seen him do it on many other occasions as well. That race over the 600 or 700 at Manawatu springs to mind as well, where he never looked the winner until he found the inside charge through. So that's what makes him a champion. He finds a way to win when it doesn't look like he's a chance. And obviously, come Sunday, that's a possibility as well.
Well, let's now take a look at heat number two. Gold Star Carlito wins this by 1/100th of a second faster than No Keeper. Not setting up the speed again, though, Rosso. He does get handy enough off his draw, but it's Big Time Epic who initially sets up this field with her good second phase acceleration.
Yeah, and obviously there's trouble under the first bend, as we see, and Epic gets out to a big, big lead here, and Gold Star Carlito's back the inside, and even from here, he doesn't get the kindest of runs. Nighthawk style in the green and white rug's also got a fair bit of work to do here, Andy. A lap from home, Carlito's got a lot to do. And to be fair, it doesn't get clean from here either, because he sort of ran out of room coming off the back and had to go three wide.
There comes a point halfway down the back, or just off the back, where I thought, gee boy, at least hold on to four here and qualify for the final, because things weren't looking good for him. But Gee, we talk about champion qualities, and he gets to the outside here. He puts the shoulder into a greyhound on the corner, continues his forward momentum, and somehow still pulls six lengths off Big Time Epic, who was running time out in front. So we talk about champion qualities, and in that heat, Carlito certainly was showing a whole lot of those.
To say both of the runs were phenomenal, weren't they? It's just such a good final, and you can see that here, as you allude to, with Carlito getting that trouble on the first bend. So let's have a look at the stats again for heat number two. You can see 1:47.08, 18:60, very good sprint time for Big Time Epic Rosso, and a run home of 16:59. So a little bit down on keeper, but not surprising with him getting held up, Andy.
Yeah, it was a little bit down, but as you say, got held up, and he got held up at a crucial point off the back straight when that split would be starting. So it certainly means that his run home a little bit slower, but again, he's taken the best part of six or seven lengths off the leader who would have started that sectional off. So although a little bit slower than keeper, still very, very good, and given a clean run, gee, we've got a race coming on our hands on Sunday.
Oh, absolutely we do. Well, we're speaking about Gold Star Carlito, so it's a perfect time to bring in his trainer, Riley Evans. A very good morning to you, Riley. And look, what a fantastic heat win from the dog. He was held up a little bit there on Thursday. How's he come through that run?
Yeah, he's come through pretty good, and he travelled home well, and he's bouncing around like he always does, and he's taken no ill effect from the run, so that's good. We're a bit nervous the first time he back-to-back 700s week to week, and in the Kingston Cup, and he was good enough to win there. So the travel on top of that's a bit hard, but yeah, I definitely think he's good enough to have a good showing in the final.
And Riley, once you've got over the worry of him bouncing back from 779 metres and some travel, then you worry about the draw. So when the draw came up and you get the red rug, no keepers in six, and the others are drawn as they are, what was the feeling there at Gold Star Racing Camp?
It's a bit of mixed emotions. He certainly prefers seven or eight and get into clean air, but yeah, that's sort of where I would have preferred him. The next best obviously would have been the ace. I thought I'm not really a fan of squeeze draws, and there's a couple that can fly off the lids in the final. So yeah, if he can track through and behind Gina, there'd be something I'd like to see. I certainly think if he gets on behind her, I'd certainly think he could run her down, but yeah, it's a bit tricky. I mean, you almost look like you're drawn to win it, but it's greyhound racing and nothing's ever a guarantee. So, yeah, we're hopeful that he can have a good run.
Riley, talk us through the preparation for Carlito, because obviously he had a few 600s where he was very good, but we hadn't seen him step up to the 700-metre journey. When did the 700-metre races come on the radar for you and the team?
Well, all the big races, they're mainly over 700, and we are certainly all a fan of Stayers, me, Mum and Dad, and the Silver Collar's the one race I've always wanted to win, and I consider it the biggest race of the year, so I've always wanted to have a crack at that, and just every 600 he got stronger and stronger, and when Keeper held the record at Annington over 600, he got within a length of that, so he's obviously pretty good in the 600, so we just had to have a crack at the 700, and yeah, he was good enough to beat Keeper in the heat of the Kingston Cup first go, and yeah, we were lucky enough to beat him in the final too. So he hasn't had it easy in about any of his 700s, but he's managed to pull through, and he's undefeated. He's undefeated besides one where he got beat by a champion dog, which is no keeper.
Just on no keeper, Riley, if he were to somehow get in front of you, do you think Gold Star Carlito can run him down?
It's hard to say, to be honest. I think both dogs are very, very even at the time. Like, even though Keeper's getting a bit on now, and that's the truth, he's still an absolute champion, and to even win the collar once is a big ask, but I'm not sure. There's only one way to find out, and the only time one of them's run the other down was early on when Carlito's racing in 600s, and Kevy got over the top of them there. But yeah, I think the two dogs are very, very even. Obviously, the two heats are near identical in terms of both finding trouble in the same time, having to run a leader down, and so it's hard to say, but yeah, there's only one way to find out. Maybe if we were right behind him, leading on the first corner or something, maybe, but yeah, it's hard to say.
Riley, one of your other passions is driving cars fairly fast round and round in a circle, and I'm just wondering whether you get more nervous about doing that or about greyhound racing, and what are your nerves like as the collar gets closer?
Nah, nowhere near as nervous as I am for racing, and that's saying something. So, yeah, it sort of depends on what we're racing for at Speedway. You get a little bit nervous, but, yeah, I'm out there with a whole bunch of my mates, and it's up to me. So, yeah, you're putting the body on the line doing that. But, yeah, this is a race I've always wanted to win, as I've said, and I'd love to add the collar into our trophy cabinet, but it's no easy feat. We got to run down, or we got to beat an absolute champion and the best stayer of all time, in my opinion, which is Keeper. And yeah, I'm just hoping for a clean run's all I'm hoping for, and if we can get that, then maybe it's his race to take. But yeah, greyhound racing, anything can happen.
Certainly can, Riley, but thanks very much for joining us. We wish you all the best of luck, and we'll go let you put that polish on Gold Star Carletto.
Thank you very much, guys. Have a good night.
That was Riley Evans joining us. It's time now to take a break on our special greyhound preview. Off the other side, we'll be going through them runner by runner.
That is exceptionally close, but I think Aquamouse has got it.
One of the best silver collar finishes in history, I think, there, Rosso. And not only that, of course, but the commentary from one Peter Early are something you won't forget.
No, indeed. Just magnificent. I mean, Peter's brought the race to life, really, and has been a very big part of why the silver collar is special to us. And that was just a classic commentary. And I don't even know how he did it, because there were dogs coming from everywhere, and the dog who was miles in front didn't even run in the money. But he's kind of summed it up so well, and it was just all natural stuff that Peter was able to do. And of course, Aaron White called his first collar last year, did a terrific job with Kevy, and he will again too. But yeah, never forget that race. I always pull it out of the locker. John Good with Aquamouse, he'd won it the year before with Aquarattle. Actually ran down a dog of mine who was three lengths in front, and Aquarattle got up for John, who owned and trained it. And then the following year, he was behind Aquamouse, although Dallas Van Muen did help him through the actual winning of the silver collar with the mouse.
It was an incredible race, wasn't it? And we saw a lot of speed early in that race, as we alluded to. So let's have a look at this year's speed map and see who we think may be leading it up. And we've mapped a Pawagina and Big Time Epic to get forward here, Rosso. I think just based purely probably on what they did in the heats.
Really looking at the heats here, and obviously Epic had the overall fastest time to the split of 1860 to Gina's 1875. But Epic's back half of that first split, if you like, was the best. And Gina was very quick off the lids, and Epic not quite so, but then she exploded clear when the trouble was there. No Keeper, look, he can mix his jumps. We could argue that Gold Star Carletto can too. But just to give us a rough idea into the first bend, we'd certainly expect Gina and Epic to be forward again. And then hopefully the two favourites kind of parked up in behind somewhere close enough.
Yeah, I'd love to see it. I mean, we can map these races all we want, but the greyhounds have to do it on the day. So we'll start with top of the book now, Gold Star Carletto. He is trained by Riley Evans, by Dinah Double One out of Dave's Dot. And you can see there's track distance stats, 1 for 1. And what a brilliant statistic through from the inside alley, Andy, which is quite interesting with Riley wanting them drawn out wider.
Yeah, it's one of those interesting things. I think pre-box draw, I thought box 1 or box 8 would be perfect for him. So he came up with box number 1. Just the way the field maps around him, good as well. Speed in 2, speed in 4. Not a whole lot of pressure down on him into the first corner. So he should just be able to nestle right in behind these leaders going around this first corner. And all things being equal, Pip, it looks like he'll secure a cleaner run than Keeper. Is that the difference between running first and second? I guess we'll find out on Sunday.
We certainly will, Andy. And that's the thing too, Rosa. We saw it in his heat. He can take a couple of knocks. He can get held up. So even if he doesn't get maybe that clean run through, he might be able to overcome it.
Yeah, we need a reminder, I think, of just how good he is. Over the 520 metres, for example, he's won a host of Class 5 races in decent times. He ran second in the Group 2 Far South Challenge down at Ascot Park behind Postman Pat. And we're marvelling at what Pat's doing in Australia at the moment. His first win was a sprint in a 17:45, and that was off box number one. So he's got that speed that you need as a modern-day stayer. And then he's out of Dave's Dot, and she won a 770-metre race at Forbury Park, and she did headed for fourth in the Kingston Cup, which her boy, Gold Star Carlito, went on and won recently in great tussles with no keeper. And I really hope it sets up like that again, because their match races at Addington have been something to behold.
Oh, absolutely they have been, and they're always taking ground off each other. And as you allude to, he went 29.71 not that long ago at Addington Raceway. So he's got the speed and he's got the stamina, and he's the deserved favourite to number one, Gold Star Carlito. So number two in the book is a Power Gina for Jean and Dave Fahey. She's by Fernando Bale. What a sire he's been out of a Power racer. You can see there, one look at the track for a second in her heat. 3 from 1 and 1 off the alley. And I thought that was a really courageous run, because it was her first 700-metre race, Rosso. First up on the track, and she put herself in the race nice and early.
Yeah, look, she did run second in the Auckland Oaks last year over the 5.27, but it was a terrific performance first up over 700 for a greyhound, having her fifth start back after a serious injury, a hip support, hock strain. Then she came in season, which Dave Fahey thought actually in the long run might have been good for her. But Andy McCook, when I was there at Addington on New Zealand Oaks night, and I marvelled at the fresh up run of Opawa Gina for a placing over the 520 metres, I never ever thought we'd be talking about her as third favourite for the Duke of Edinburgh Silver Collar.
You've just got to marvel at the team that is Jean and David Fahey, don't you? And the things that they are able to achieve with these greyhounds. As you say, five starts ago was her first go for 10 months. 4 days later, she went around and won a 600. And I'll put my hand up and say I potted her that day. I thought she was no chance of winning when I was calling it. Straight to the lead and bolted in. That'll teach me for trying to doubt Jean and David Fahey, Pip, because we know how good they are. We know that this little greyhound's got speed. She can race on pace, and if there's any trouble in behind, she might be the greyhound who's looking to take advantage.
Absolutely, Andy. That was my logic as well. I just have a feeling they could put that little bit extra polish on her first run over the 700 metres. Does it flatten her? Does it bring her into it? I'm not sure, but I couldn't leave her out of my four. She definitely does look a nice contender. Let's move on to runner number three in the book now, Nighthawk Style for Matthew Roberts, who does train the wee girl. She took on the Silver Collar Series last season and unfortunately didn't get through in her heat, but she has this year. She's had four looks here at the track for two minor players. Placings. And one thing with her, Andy, she does lack that early pace, but she'll just stay all day.
Yeah, she does. You look at her overall record and she's 4 from 75, but to be fair to her, she's never been scared to have a crack at the big boys, and the team have always targeted her at these 700 metre features, and she's been racing over this journey basically her entire career. And when you're racing a dog like No Keeper week in, week out, it's very hard to put many wins on the board. So I think her record doesn't quite do her justice. She'll go around at a long price come Sunday. Not sure she'll feature, but she does come up with a draw that she should be able to use.
Absolutely, and it was good to see in the heat too. She managed to get past a dog like Novella late in the piece, and that's the key with her. If she puts her mind to the job, she really can stay out these distances.
Yeah, indeed. Look, she was a distant second in the heat last year to No Keeper. She'd beaten about 15 lengths, sixth in the final. She's the only other dog to return from that collar final last year, with No Keeper obviously being the other, the defending champion. Look, she's out of Nighthawk Rose, and I've seen pictures of all of them from a young pup, because prominent handler in the Central District's Kim Fraser, he part owns these dogs, including Nighthawk Style, and so I've seen them develop on Kim's phone, and it's just tremendous that she's back for another crack at the Silver Collar. It's not easy to do, and with a little bit of drama up in front of her, she could run into a podium finish.
She could. Well, let's now move on to number four in the book, Big Time Epic for Lisa Cole. Only a trainer to not won the Silver Collar for, and with such a good record in all other Group 1s. And she was a bitch that was very, very good in her heat too. 1860 for the sprint, Rosso. And that was her first go over the 700 metres as well.
It was, and she's been the 660 metre queen. She's been winning those for fun lately at Palmerston North. Her first nine starts were sprints, and her first two wins were 375 and 410 there on the horseshoe. Look, Boyes H. Avatar, who's a United States Hall of Fame greyhound and out of Kissing Gwyneth, who brought up the $1 million in stakes last week, which is just something else from her five litters. And I'm really pleased for the BBC Syndicate and for the Cold Kennels that Epic is what she is, because they lost big time Kiss, and she was out of Kissing Gwyneth, but she was by Blazing Bomber, the brother to Ring the Bell, so she could have been anything as a stayer. Andy, from watching greyhounds like this in the past, and if you ask, will they get stronger, will they get flattened? Well, I'm not going to sit here and say I know, but my general feeling from watching dogs like her is they'll find it tough again this coming week.
Yeah, it's one of those things. It's a bit of a flip of the coin for me. It's kind of 50-50, and she's had a prep where she's nice and fit, ready to go for the heat. So potentially after that she goes forward, maybe she goes backwards. It's always hard to know. She was sitting down quite badly, obviously, in the sort of the last 20 or 30 metres, which might indicate she might just be flattened off a little bit after the run. But we know Team Cole know how to win Group 1s, and if she's ready to rock and roll, sets them up in front again, much like Gina, she might be the greyhound in the right place at the right time.
Absolutely. Well, that's big time Epic. And now let's move on to a dog wearing my colour, Raja Bale. He draws at box number 5 for Craig Roberts. He's another that continues to take on these distance features. He was third in the Kingston Cup. He's been on the track one time. That was his first look here over that trip for a placing. He's been there, of course, over the 527 metres. Got a fantastic distance record, Andy, but he just keeps on finding better dogs at the moment, like No Keeper and Gold Star Kaleido.
Yeah, it's sort of been a bad time to be a stayer the last couple of years, or 12 or 18 months anyway, with Big Kevy Boy being around. Been very hard for these greyhounds to try and beat him. He's a very good greyhound though, Raja. He's won 22 races. He's already won over 100k in stakes, and he continues to turn up and run really creditable races week in, week out. And as we touched on earlier, he was unlucky in his heat as well. Caught to the wrong side of Willene Bale, which is never good. Had to clear her, did some very good things through the middle and back end of his race. So I think he's a real each-way player come Sunday.
And just on that back end of this race, it was great to actually see him take those knocks but then continue to run past runners, saying that the 7.79 will be OK for him, Rosso.
I thought he was terrific. Remarkably, he's only won one from 13, 700 metres and beyond, but then lately he keeps running into No Keeper and Gold Star Carlito more recently as well. He won a 720-metre race at Palmerston North, and he was a red-hot favourite in the final, which he looked to have at his mercy and actually got tripped and fell in that, unfortunately, or his record might look a little bit better. He won an Auckland Cup heat in 2022, looked a real prospect for the final, had to be scratched out of that. I loved his run last week. I think he's very definitely a player. I'm not quite sure whether he could get Craig Roberts' third silver collar, but he could get on the podium.
He certainly could. Well, let's have a look what Dan Roberts had to say. I caught up with him on Sunday and just asked him what he thought of Raja's run.
Yeah, pretty happy with his run. I think he was fine in the line at the end, which is always the question mark at the end of 7.79. So the big question mark now is going to be how he comes through the trip and the run. Obviously, the biggest part about the silver collar is having to do it again next week. So he generally comes through his races pretty good, and we're looking forward to next week with him.
Must be pleased with the way that he stuck on this time. Obviously, he took on kind of 700 metre races last year, was tiring a bit, but this time over the 7.79 finished off really well. Why do you think that is?
Yeah, maybe just a bit of age on his side. He might have matured and settled down a little bit. He's always been a bit of a nut job around home and in the kennels and that, but he still is, to be fair. But yeah, he's definitely got age on his side nowadays, which is probably helping him.
Do you think he's a chance to make the podium?
I definitely think he is. He's going to have to put himself in the hunt early. But if he can do that, he's going to see out the 7.79 reasonably well, like he did today. So if he's in the hunt early, he's definitely a top three player.
Now time to move on to the defending champion, No Keeper, the New Zealand Greyhound of the Year last season. And he's made his way back to the final aptly. You can see his track statistics, 3 for 3. He remains unbeaten over this distance. 8 starts from the box for 2 wins and 3 minor placings. And Mark Rosanowski, he got through to this final. Not easily either, because he was held up so many times, but he's just so tenacious.
He is, and I love last year's final. It'll be one of the highlights when we go forward sort of 10 and 20. 20 years, and we'll remember No Keeper's win last year. And we might remember it this one too, if he could double up. He's been a marvellous dog right throughout, because over the 520 metres he was excellent. He's been second and fourth in Auckland Cups, let alone his collar. He's won a Group 1 over the middle distance as well. So, Andy, he always, like, he screamed out stayer. And sometimes we can say that dog's running through the line over 520, it doesn't come to fruition. But for Kevy, for everyone who said, this dog's a stayer, it did come to fruition.
Yeah, it certainly did. And he's been as good as we all thought he would be. Of course, he had his first go over 600. I think it was about 4 or 5 days after the New Zealand Cup, and he took on the Cup winner in Delisha Bale. And Delisha Bale didn't go around as favourite after winning a New Zealand Cup, which says something about No Keeper. We're sort of running out of ways to try and describe the greyhound. He's nothing short of a champion. He finds ways to win, and no doubt that'll be the same as what he'll be trying to do on Sunday. Draw Niggly, needs to clear Raja Bale, which might be a little bit of an issue in the early stages, but we know how good he is. And Pip, I still think it's one of my biggest claims to fame. Beat him on debut. Crafty told me he couldn't get beat. Flurries was too good for him.
Oh, you're going to take that one, Andy, because there's not many dogs that have beaten No Keeper. Now, let's catch up with his trainer, Gary Cleave. I just asked him on Sunday how he assessed his heat win.
Very pleased. Found a lot of trouble in the running. And when the first forward sort of broke away, I was sort of relatively confident that he would qualify. But to get up and win was a bonus.
Where do you think the defending champ is this time compared to where he was last year as far as his ability and his recovery?
He handled it all well last year. He's a good 700 metre dog, where some of the others sort of might find the backup hard. I can't say there's improvement in him, but he's in the fight.
Has he lost any of his early zip? I mean, he used to get really forward last year, where sometimes this time we've seen him come a little bit from behind, or do you think he's kind of the exact same dog?
Last start at Addington, he found the lead early and dictated things in front. Maybe just the foreign track and the noise of the lure just sort of threw him off a wee bit today. I did expect him to lead, and when he didn't, it sort of threw a spanner in the works. But he will improve with the look around here.
Now time to move on to number 7 in the book. One of the youngsters in the field, Sweet Buddy, trained by Samuel Ozell. And you have a look at his statistics. Well, he won the Auckland Stayers back in March here. He's again a greyhound who has just got a good record over this. He went 30-59 in that Auckland Stayers, Rozzo, for the 5-2-7 split. 18-75 early and 16-34, but didn't quite get as forward in his heat on Sunday.
No, he didn't. And then he did make a run that I thought was encouraging, but then Raja Bale sort of swept past him late in the piece. Look, I'd love to see Sam Lozell win this race. He went so close 2019. Shooters Hill gunning down. Dinah Wesland came up about a neck short there. And of course, 2020, Shaney. There was a crying shame that she fell in the heat, and that was a real bugger for them. Probably hard to get over too, to be frank. But Sam's granddad won it 1995. Cutie's sister. Just based on the heat run, Andy, would have to say that he would have to lift.
Yeah, he certainly would, and he might just not have that early speed that some of these greyhounds have. And when you're getting off greyhounds like Carlito and No Keeper and Raja Bale, etc., it's very hard to run back past them. But he's a good young stayer, Pip. He's got a bright future in front of him. Not sure this will be his year, but, gee, if anyone does deserve a collar, it's certainly Sam Lozell.
Oh, absolutely, Andy. And you can just see the emotion too, even after that Auckland Stayers. It's a race that he absolutely wants to win, and great for him to have a dog in the final. Let's now move on to the second of Gary Cleave's runner in the 8, No Valour. He'll complete our Silver Collar field for 2023, and you can have a look at his statistics. It was his first look the other day when running into fourth. He's 2 from the box for 2 minor placings. He actually ran second in the Kingston Cup heat. Didn't get all favours in the final, and he's a young dog, Rozzo, but he deserves his place.
He does, and he's a star of the future, and he'll benefit from what's going to happen this year, I think. Looking forward to mapping his progress. He's out of Classy Witch, and she was very capable, and she made the Silver Collar final herself. She'd finished 7th, but she's very closely related to No Keeper. She's by No Class, and she's out of and she's a half-sister to No Jinx. So, Andy, look, No Valour has got us a couple of times in terms of being a black book, and then maybe just a fraction disappointed on the back of that. So what are you expecting backing up after that heat run?
Yeah, it's hard to know how he'll handle the backup. Obviously, he's a youngster as well. didn't handle the backup from the Kingston Cup all that well, it has to be said. I was pretty keen on him to run into the money in that final because, gee, in his heat, he was very unlucky. I thought he should have won that heat. He came together with Centurion into the back, and then he sort of got ahead of him and he got on heels leaving the back and had to regather all his momentum and was chasing Centurion down at the line. So not sure the backup or the travel will be that good for a young greyhound, but he's certainly got a future over ground, and whatever he does, he'll only keep improving.
Yeah, that's the key too. That's exactly what Gary said to me on Sunday. He's just a little bit young. He said maybe next year could be his winning turn for the collar. Well, that's the full field. It's now time for our selections and how we want to play Sunday. We'll start with you, Rosso. Who are you going with?
I'm going with Gold Star Carlito off the inside, hoping obviously that Gina and Epic get forward and that he takes up a prominent position inside. I thought his run in the heat obviously was outstanding. He's been very good beating no keeper recently at Addington, including the Group 2 Kingston Cup. And even when he was defeated by no keeper, Carlito's run was really, really good. Like the 220, no keeper, I've got it in. I'd like to be wrong. I'd love to see no keeper win back-to-back. That would be outstanding. A par with Gina, well, I think she's going to be out of trouble and get her chance. And Raja Bale is very keen on his run in the heat. So a bit boring there, I've got to say. I'm pretty much with the market.
Andy, I have a feeling that you're with the one in the book as well, Gold Star Carlito on top.
Hard to go past him, although he's not past the post by any means, but the way the draw has panned out, I think it's his race and he deserves to be favourite. Obviously, you've got to have Kevy Boy in there, no keeper. I think we'd all love to see him win back-to-back collars, and if ever a greyhound deserved to do it, it certainly is him. Big time Epic, I flipped the coin and came up with her in for third. Like Rosso said, she either goes backwards or forwards off the run, but we know Team Cole know how to win Group 1s, and if she goes forwards, then she should be in there for a long old way, and Raja Bale wouldn't surprise me at all to see the old boy finding the podium.
And I hate to be boring, but I'm with the Gold Star Carlito as well. And I can't add much more than the team as far as why we like his chances and no keeper as well. I think I would have had them switched around with the draws, but the way they've come up in the field, I'm 1-6. And then I'm going to chuck in a par with Gina. I do like the way she stepped up there in her first 700 metre race. She's chained by Jean and Dave Fay, and I have an inkling she's got a bit of improvement out of her. And I'm sticking with Big Time Epic, actually. I was really pleased with her as well. First 700 metres, I think she might be able to sneak into the top four. That's what we're liking on Sunday for the 2023 Duke of Edinburgh Silver Collar. Time to take a break. Don't go anywhere. Off the other side, we'll be touching on the Waterloo Cup.
But they come for home, and it's Thrilling Brat. Thrilling Brat, you're not a brat, you're a beaut. He wins it.
Karen, that must be one of the biggest thrills you've had in greyhound race. Not only have you won it with this fella, but you've finaled it as well.
I'm absolutely ecstatic. These two little dogs, you know, they just never let us down. They're just amazing animals.
I'm wondering where the day went. The clouds have me shrouded in grey, but I'm still out.
She comes round the outside, Swift Fantasy. It's not a dream, it's a fantasy. It's a Swift Fantasy. Gets him nicely.
Work went out of cool, I'm down, we found an escape from work. And I love her, cause that's what your hard work gets you. My heart bursts through my chest, I'm rescued.
Oh, wouldn't be a Silver Collar preview show without showing a little Swift Fantasy. What a greyhound she was. But it's now time to turn our attention to the other Group 1 feature on the day, and it is the Waterloo Cup. And what a field. I mean, we've got a triple Group 1 winner in there, a dual Group 1 winner in there, and a Group 1 winner. That's just three of the greyhounds. So we'll start with the full field here with Talbingo Bale.
Yeah, Talbingo Bale is the defending champion, and he's been outstanding in runs so far at Auckland with an incredible 29.88 last year.
The champ himself, Opawa Superstar, he's won 30 from 49, he's 3 from 4 on the track. He's been there, done that. He's not very big in stature, but he's got a massive heart, and he's a big chance in the Waterloo Cup.
Blazing Master is dog number 3, and the Lisa Cole Kennels are to the 4 here with 4 runners, including this dog, who is a tenacious and close second to Big Time Blazer in the heat.
Space Boy comes up with box number 4. He knows how to win big races. He's got a stack of strength on his side. He might be the greyhound who just posies up in behind runners and looks to get to the outside and run home late. We potted him in the Auckland Cup. We know how that turned out. He's looking for another Group 1 today.
Dog number five is Federal Infrared. She's been quite outstanding at Palmerston North, and her last win was a Group 2 North Island Championship there. But of course, we know she can do it on the two-turn tracks. She pushed Opawa Superstar so close in the New Zealand Cup.
A greyhound that has really come of age in the last sort of month or so is Golden Logger. For Glenn Hodgson, he only trains a small team, but he gets his star through to the Waterloo Cup. And after seeing the track a couple of starts ago, he's right in the mix, and he's a chance come Sunday.
Dog number seven is Big Time Blazer, fourth runner here for the Lisa Cole Kennels, winner of the heat on the track at Manukau, where she's been quite adept at using her early pace, which is going to be critical for her to overcome the draw of box number seven.
Opawa Linda completes the race for Gina David-Fahey. She came oh so close to nailing her first Group 1 in the New Zealand Oaks, only to be downed by Jovita. But she comes up with box number 8 again for a Group 1 final. It's a draw that suits her, and after her win in her heat, she's not the worst.
Absolutely not, and she's sitting in the market at $9. But our favourite is Opawa Superstar at $2.80. That means Talbingo Bale off the inside alley. Last year's winner is at $7.50. Federal Infrared and Golden Logger around that $5, $6 mark. Rozzo, have they got the right favourite, and can you see value?
Well, Opawa Superstar is a dog always to be feared, and he should be unbeaten at Manukau because he got run off at the bend in the Auckland Cup, and he'd won the Auckland Cup the year before. So he's got an incredible record there. Have to say, obviously, he was beaten on merit by Opawa Linda and Talbingo Bale at Addington. He's 5 from 5, box number 2. So there's reasons 280, and there's reasons to say maybe we look elsewhere for some value.
Absolutely. What about you, Andy? Do you like anything for value in that?
I think the obvious value is dog number 1 in Talbingo Bale. Gee, he was very good in his heat down here. First race for a long time. He's been lightly raced with a few issues, but he was absolutely super. Comes up with a draw he can use. Things look good for Talbingo. If he goes forward off that heat, $7.50 looks a really tasty price.
Well, speaking of him, let's have a look at him in his heat. Taken out by Opawa Linda, the first of the Waterloo Cup heats. There's a couple of dogs you want to highlight. Linda in the black and white stripes of box number 2. Talbingo Bale just sensational off the lids here, Rozzo, but Linda soon got past him.
He was, and he went across the face of Opawa Superstar early as well. Linda shows really good speed here, the New Zealand Oaks runner-up to go past Talbingo. But Andy, the incredible thing was the way that Talbingo came back at her, and in a pretty decent time for the night as well.
It was a super run from him. We hadn't seen him since the 2nd of March, so he'd had a big spell. He'd had a few issues. The team have done a super job to get him back to the track, and to be fair, not a mile off his best, considering how big a break he had had. He comes up with a draw he can use in the final, and if he can get off the lids as clean as he did here, we know how good he is. He's a 29.88 dog around Auckland. Not many break the 32nd here, team, and if he can find the lure early stages, he'll make it very interesting.
And that was Opawa Superstar as well, running third and behind. Just missed the kick a little bit, but the start prior did hold off Opawa Conan in that sub 30 seconds. So you know he's still got it in him. As we move on to heat number 2, out of Whanganui. Now you're looking for Golden Logger here. He takes out this heat. Federal Infrared, also the other runner qualifying through with just the 2. So he's in the 5. Federal Infrared second here, Rozzo. And what a lead up from Golden Logger.
Indeed, 488, that's just magnificent. That's as good as they go there. And, of course, we know he's got a bit of strength about him as well. Thought Federal Infrared was very good here, Andy, in the black and white stripes here, because she got an early knock in her fresh-up run and she'd faded late there, but she hung in for the fight. So two really good qualifiers here.
Yeah, super. Really good to see Glenn get a finalist in a Group 1. As I said, he only trains a small team, and gee, he's got this boy absolutely airborne at the moment, Golden Logger, and if he can come out clean like he has been, then they'll certainly know he's in the race and he's seen Auckland, which will be an aid. And obviously Federal Infrared been fairly lightly raced in recent months, so she should only be improving as well, and we know how good she is when she finds the lure.
Oh, absolutely. Of course, runner-up in the New Zealand Cup. As we now move on to heat number 3 out of Manukau, and very apt too, talking about Federal Infrared, because this is a Lisa Cole trifecta here. You're looking for Big Time Blazer, Blazing Master, bit of a tongue twister there, and Space Boy, who runs into third, but it's Blazer with her early speed that gets her the win.
It was. Look, she's young, but she's got this early pace, and that's critical. Blazing Master took a bit of a chop there into that first bend as things got really tight, and Space Boy moved into what I thought might be a winnable position for the Auckland Cup winner there, but he did close off well, Andy. Look, The two greyhounds up front can get forward, and Space Boy, we know, he can pounce if there's any squeezing.
Yeah, certainly can. It was a good heat, this. She was good leading all of the way, big-time blazer. The draw a little niggly potentially, a fair bit of speed inside of her to try and get around, but we know that she can ping off the lids, and we know how good Space Boy is when he gets into clean air, and he'll be looking to charge late in the piece. Any trouble in front of him, he'll be looking to take advantage.
Absolutely. Well, those are the three heats that we wanted to touch on. We're going to take a break now, and then off the other side, we better dive through them runner by runner.
They swing for home. Aussie, Aussie, Aussie. Ring the bell. Kicks. He gets away nicely. But up they come. Dusty Gambler out wide. Ring the bell. Boom, boom. He's home. Ring the bell. Ring the bell. The first greyhound ever to back-to-back silver collars. Outside comes Bet on Bessie and Wald Burton last later. Up they come and Bet on Bessie, she's home. Bet on Betty, Bessie got a cruise to Quinella. Well done. Back then, you can stand me up at the gates
of hell, but back then. Oh, one of my favourite ever silver collars. One of the great reasons that I love this game. And another is our fantastic greyhounds. And we had a tight shot there on a certain trophy from our resident historian here at Trackside. Rozzo, tell us about this.
Well, this is the 1937 Waterloo Cup that was handed out. It was actually shared. It was shared by a dog called Why Hurry, another one called Ruriatu. And Why Hurry was actually trained by E.J. Wing, who for years, decades, the Wellington Club ran an E.J. Wing memorial. Look, I wasn't there, but I have had this come into my presence, and I must admit it will probably need a little bit of elbow grease, but I thought it was too good an opportunity not to have the 37 edition of the Waterloo Cup. It's a race that goes back to 1878. It's got a ridiculous history.
Oh, absolutely it does. We can tell that with this trophy that looks like it's been around for a very long time. Just quickly before we do touch through these dogs runner by runner, just wanted our apologies there. We were going to try and get Glenn Hodson on the phone. Unfortunately, we haven't been able to. He might just be busy training his greyhounds, but we'll surely catch up with him on Sunday. So let's start with them runner by runner, and we'll have a look at the number one, the reigning champ, Intel Bingo Bale. Actually, before we do, we better talk about the speed, because this could be key, Rozzo. A lot of it out wide with Big Time Blazer and Golden Logger trying to maybe angle down towards that rail.
Yeah, indeed. And Tel Bingo and Apawa Superstar, they're going to be looking to hold up on the inside. We've got Federal Infrared, who can really get out and hum. there could be a lot of pressure into this first bend, Andy, and you know, that would be a worry. And obviously, it does provide an opportunity for a dog like Space Boy or Blazing Master just to pick their way through should there be some bother.
Yeah, it certainly does, because we know Tel Bingo and Superstar can pick it when they're on as well. So it could be an absolute war into this first turn, and there's not a lot of turf there to try and fight over either. So could just be an Opawa Linda or a Space Boy out the back missing all of that, looking to charge home late. But that first corner will be absolutely paramount.
It will be. Well, let's touch on number one in the book, because he might need to try and really hold up that rail with the pressure coming down on him. He's a dual Group 1 winner, taking out the Waterloo Cup last season and the South Island Champs. He's the oldest in the field. Core statistics, 3 starts for 2 wins and a minor placing. And it would be such a story, Rozzo, if he won this race with his injury woes, but he looks like he's come back in great form.
Back in the day, and I'm talking some of them in the 1800s, some of them in the early 1900s, there were dogs that won Waterloo Cups back-to-back, very different race. And in the modern era, it hasn't happened. There was a dual winner, 79-80, Laurel Streak. It was an outstanding greyhound, but it would be quite something else for Tel Bingo to be able to do that. And quite frankly, when I saw him in the heats, I thought, well, OK, you may as well give it a shot, you know, but I didn't expect him to qualify. And I certainly didn't expect him to qualify in the manner that he did, and I didn't expect that I would be putting him on top. He's not a rail painter. He does, you know, he's out of width or two, but he can do that. He's got the ability to do that. He muscles up, and he's a really good race dog. Two of his last 3 wins have been Group 1s, the South Island Champs and the Waterloo Cup, and in between he won a heat at the South Island Champs. Andy McCook, Craig Roberts, he's the king of the Waterloo Cup. 25 years since Flash Happy got the first of five. Tell Bingo did it last year. Of course, 2020, Leonard Bale and Dinah Vickers in between with Daphne Bale. It's quite a record.
Yeah, it certainly is. And Tell Bingo a chance of adding to it as well. Like you say, not a rail painter, but he's big enough and bulshy enough to put the shoulder in when he needs to. And gee, Pip, if he's taken any benefits out of that heat run, which you would expect he has, he's got to be a really good each-way player come Sunday.
Well, I had to catch up with Dan Roberts on Sunday and just asked him how he has come through his heat on Thursday.
Yeah, he's come through it pretty well. He's a hard dog for us to sort of get a read on. He's been so up and down over the last couple of months, and that's why he hasn't really been racing. But no, it was good to see him. He walked off the track in pretty good condition.
What's Craig done with him? Because he's obviously had his injury woes. He's come back in really good form. Is he any little secret there?
Don't want to give too much away. No, we've actually adopted a new cell therapy mat, which seems to be helping him a lot. I mean, it's not going to work for all dogs, but he's definitely come on leaps and bounds since we've started putting him on that.
Where do you think he is compared to where he was this time last year when he was really putting some good times up on the track?
He was only just beaten in a 29.99 on Thursday, so I don't think he's too far off his best. Whether he'll get back to where he was this time last year, I can't say, but I think he will be a big improver from that run. The only thing different nowadays is he's probably just lacking a wee bit of pure pace, but he's hitting the line as good as ever. And yeah, I mean, he won this race last year in a 29.88. Whether I think he can do that this year, probably not, but I think he can definitely trouble them.
Number two in the book is a power superstar, the three-time Group 1 winner, including the Auckland Cup up at Manukau. He comes up with box number two, the dog by Fernando Bale, out of a power tab. Four starts on the course, three wins, and Rosso, as you alluded to, very unlucky not to make that four from four.
Look, if this dog had had a little bit of luck, he could have won two New Zealand Cups and two Auckland Cups. As it is, he's got one of each, and he got third in Auckland Cup. He won an Auckland Cup, and then he had that horror run in March when he looked the winner going into the first bend. So, Andy McCook, your thoughts around this dog and his heat run, where he was clearly outpointed on the night by a Powerlinda and Tell Bingo Bale, but he is a phenomenon. He's got $264,000 in the bank.
Yeah, we know how good he is, and we know how good his conditioners are as well to have them ready to rumble on the right day. Two starts ago, he led all the way. Apoa Konan was half running him down late in the piece, got close, but he held 29.92. So hard to say he's at his absolute best at the moment, Opawa Superstar, but when they're breaking 32 starts ago, it's hard to pot them. He's got to be well and truly in the mix, and if anyone can get him ready to rumble for Sunday, it's Team Fahey.
Oh, absolutely. We say that all the time as we move on to number three in the book, Blazing Master, one of four for Lisa Cole in the final field. He's a greyhound that's an absolute rail painter. Six starts on the course, two wins, three placing. So only out of the money once, Rosso, and I think he'll be helped with the draw today.
Yeah, and he won on Auckland Cup Day when we were there, the Dallas Van Muen Memorial, and does seem to run the place really well. Overcame, you know, a fair bit of traffic at that first bend, a lot of tightening, and there could be here in this final two, Andy, and he muscled up there and he nearly got to big time Blazer. So you'd have to say he's got probably the race ability to survive anything at the first bend that might go on.
He certainly has. He's good through the middle and back end of his races, isn't he? So if he's not in front, you know you're still a chance, which could be a good thing in a race like this with all that burn into the first quarter and a few greyhounds who need to lead to win. So certainly looks some sort of each-way player in what appears to be a very even Waterloo Cup.
Yeah, I agree. I think he needs to get up on the speed, but he's got that strength on the side, and I can see him running into the top four as we move on to Space Boy, the Group 1 Auckland Cup winner, another Group 1 winner in the field. He's a dog that lacks that early speed. He does it all from the back end. Rosso finishes off his race as well. Five starts on the course, three wins and a minor placing. Look, it could be a good thing for him this time, being slow away from the boxes.
I think that would be ideal for him because there does look to be quite a bit of pressure going into the first bend, and then obviously he gets an opportunity to do what he did in the Auckland Cup. He's proven that that was no fluke, and he took that opportunity really well. He's looked outstanding from the off. He won his first four there at Palmerston North, running class five times right from the off. And he'd be a remarkable feat for a dog this young to go Auckland Cup, Waterloo Cup. And I know he's double figure odds, but it wouldn't be a shock.
Wouldn't be a shock at all. And I think we said for the Auckland Cup, probably can't win it, and look at what he was able to do. So I'm not going to pot him again. He does have plenty of strength on his side. He broke 30 seconds at Addington not long ago, so he's a very, very good greyhound. Got a very bright future in front of him, and if things went his way, he'll be looking to storm over top of them late.
Speaking of very good greyhounds, we're moving on to number five in the book, Federal Infrared, runner-up in the New Zealand Cup last season, Group 2 winner of the North Island Champs. She's only had the two starts back this preparation, a little bit unlucky off the lids first up, Rosso, but improved markedly into second in the Waterloo Cup heat.
Yeah, she copped a real knock out of the lids in her fresh-up run, and then she showed real burn that we know that she's got, and then she paid for it at the back end there. But she's terrific. And we saw in the New Zealand Cup that she pushed Power Superstar to the limit. There's a sense of timing. She's had that other race where she was pretty good and behind Golden Logger, and she kind of hung on to his tails, and you know, he can run right through the line. So I thought she did really well. Outstanding greyhound. The Colt Kennels have won with two of the very best, Little Mother, a Waterloo Cup winner, and Big Time Paddy. Andy, and in Federal Infrared, just got this feeling we might see a flash of gold into the first bend, and she'll make things really interesting if she can get there first.
Yeah, she certainly will. We know how good she is. Of course, very good in the New Zealand Cup. No doubting she's got the speed to win. Draw a little bit niggly, Pip, but if she can get there in front, as Rosso said, she'll be there for a very long way.
Yeah, got a little inkling that she'll be right in the fight as we move on to number six in the book, Golden Logger for Glenn Hodson. He's a dog that actually remains unbeaten since resuming in April on the two-turn track. He's one from one on the course. Stuart Manukau headed up there not long ago, Rosso, put pay to a nice field and deserves his place in the final.
Came back as a class four dog for the Still Working Syndicate. Now, they were there. They were underneath me on Friday when he won that heat, and they were ecstatic, as you'd expect them to be. And well done to Glenn Hodgson and the Still Working Syndicate, and they've got a very definite chance here. Of course, not that long ago, 2015, Glenn did have Kill Churn in the final. He was a Group 1 winner. And as well as that, Andy, the dog ran fourth in the Waterloo Cup, Group 1 winner, and won, what, 22 from 34, and had to be scratched out of a New Zealand Cup. So, fair to say that Glenn Hodgson's got another very good one here who might be able to even do better in the Waterloo Cup than Kill Churn.
Yeah, he certainly could. He's got speed. Got him well and truly in the numbers. Always good to see the small guys getting some runners through to the Group 1s, and he looks a real chance here, Golden Logger.
Number seven in the book is a Big Time Blazer. Speaking of early speed, she's got it in spades. She won the Waterloo Cup heat by doing that off box number three. She's seven starts on the course for three wins and two minors. She needs to use that early speed, Rosso, because I do find she's a little bit weaker than a few of these in the back end.
Yeah, they nearly caught a Blazer and Master and Space Boy in that heat, but it's the early speed that she's got. She made the New Zealand Oaks final. Unfortunately, she fell in that final, but she took no ill effect. She bounced back very well. She won the Winsome Ashley Trophy on Auckland Cup Day. So yeah, it's really about her. She's got to be a clear leader at that first bend. But she was the $7,000 Waikato Maiden winner around New Year, and she's gone terrific since.
Oh, absolutely she has. And number eight in the book, completing the Waterloo Cup final, is a Power Linda for Robin Wales and Gina Dave Fahey. She's a bitch who, of course, was runner-up in New Zealand Oaks, Andy, and she deserves her place in this final.
Very good young greyhound. Of course, we knew from day one with the name Opawa Linda that she must have been very good. She doesn't have a lot of early speed. Box 8 suits her style. She's very good through the middle stages of her races. A little bit vulnerable lately in the sort of the concluding stages. But Pip, again, if there's any congestion into the first turn, Linda might be a greyhound who could miss it, and wouldn't surprise me at all to see her figuring in the finish.
Absolutely not. She's an astute greyhound, isn't she? And that is a look at your 2023 final field for the Waterloo Cup. And that's all the time we've got on the show. Thank you for tuning in. We've picked you a winner or two. Thanks, Mark Rosanowski, for joining us. Looking forward to Sunday. You'll be on course with me and Andy McCook. I'm sure you'll be beaming in from Christchurch. Thanks for joining us. Catch all the action. TAB Trackside 1 Sunday at Waterloo Cup and at the Silver Collar.